action.
Hey, everyone.
Hey.
JD. Hope you're all doing well this morning. I'm going to chat for a little bit about the internet, which is that thing that is making your cyber wizardry communicate across lots of different computers, for example, yours and a server somewhere. So, just to see where you guys are at so far, how many of you have heard the term server? Okay, and in the context of server, client? Okay, and connection? And stream? Okay, what about HTTP? Okay, what about HTTP methods, like GET and POST? Okay, what about TCP/IP? What about packet switching or circuit switching? Cool. So, when you whip up your phone or your laptop or any internet device and you bring up a web browser and you say, I want www.google.com, and then you hit return or press a button or whatever on your phone or computer, and something happens. And then you get back a whole bunch of HTML, which I didn't ask about, but you all know what HTML. You get back a bunch of HTML, which your browser then renders. So the question is, what happens between when you say, I want this web page, www.google.com, and your browser gets that web page and then does its own rendering and stuff, which I gather you learn about, or have learned about, or will learn about later. Okay. So this question is like four levels of technology deep, and it really starts down at, I'll start with a historical perspective. Some of the first systems that people ever used to communicate across distance were telephones, right? Yeah, we had telegraphs before, but people didn't have really a telegraph at their house, generally. But people had telephones in their homes, and there were lots of them. And the way that they initially worked is that there would be an operator somewhere in the middle. So you'd pick up your phone, and you would say, I want to talk to, you know, Bob down the street or whatever. The operator would be like, oh yes, Bob. And there would be like physical sockets that the operator would take a literal wire and connect your phone directly to Bob's phone so that you actually had like effectively a solid conductor, a solid piece of wire between your phone and Bob's phone, plus a little bit of like amplification and stuff. Okay, this was called circuit switched networking. What that means is that there is an operator and then in later years, a physical device that would do some physical connection so that there was actually a piece of conductor between you and whoever you were talking to. Okay, we don't do that anymore. We now have a much more complex system where you'll have your phone, it doesn't even have a wire at all. It connects over some wireless network to some tower somewhere, and that tower then gets yours and a whole bunch of other phone calls, and it turns out it splits them into lots of little bits of data. It takes your voice and it crumbles it into little pieces and it sends it across the network, and then eventually it all gets to the other phone, which takes that stuff and brings it back in to just a single other voice stream. And the internet kind of works in the same way. You have a bunch of data that you want to send, that you send a request to some web server, and that web server sends some data back to you. And on both ends, your request and that data is crumbled in little bits called packets. And so now we have basically what's called a packet switch network. So instead of having a single piece of conductor, which you can imagine, like you have your phone and there's a conductor and it connects to the other phone, we have a system that takes your data, breaks it into little bits, and figures out how to make those bits get to the destination. Does that make sense? So packet switch network is great. This is a picture of what the internet looked like in 1977. I think there is an order of 50 nodes. They're sort of computer. I mean, they're computers, but I don't know that we would recognize them all as computers today. And packet switch networks, these sort of historically came because people were worried that there would be some disruption, and if there was some disruption, then we'd still want data to get, you know, like, we didn't want some disruption in Washington, D.C. to like destroy the entire network, right? We wanted to be able to send this data around potential disruptions in the network. So if you are using your circuit switched connection and you're talking to someone on the phone and and that connection gets interrupted, that's it, it's done. Whereas, you know, you might not know if there's a massive interruption in the internet because the internet is pretty solidly guarded against that kind of thing. So this is why the Defense Department was involved in the creation of the internet is because they were worried about this. They didn't like the existing phone system. Okay. So there's a whole bunch of levels here, right? What I've been talking about is how you get packets, how you get pieces of data from one part of the internet to another part of the internet, right? But there's sort of a lower level even than that. Because now, if you have a big network like this, and you want your data to get from, like, Florida up to, I don't know, the Northeast, it looks like it's actually going to go through a whole bunch of different computers on the way there. And we call those computers routers. And so there's two questions here. One is, how does the data know to get from here up to here? And two, how does the actual data, the physical data, get between individual nodes? Right? So, like, how is it that I have, you know, a picture, whatever, or I have an HTTP request, I'm requesting a piece of data. How is it that that turns into actual, like, stuff? And so this is the lowest level of the internet in most cases. It's a protocol called Ethernet. Ethernet exists when you, like, take that thick cable and plug it into your computer. Ethernet, in some slightly changed variety, is also kind of what Wi-Fi is. Ethernet protocol is also used in other places, but you're mostly going to encounter it when you're doing just like plugging your computer in or using Wi-Fi. And the way that it works is that every computer has its own hardware address. So my computer has a hardware address, and I'll show you what it is. And you can all run this on your computers as well. So on my Mac, if I run ifconfig, then I get this massive list of all of these interfaces that my computer has. And one of these is called EN1. And this is my Wi-Fi interface. And you'll notice, digging around in this giant list, I'm sorry, it's actually EN0 up here. Digging around in this giant list that there's an Ethernet hardware address. Right, and I'm going to unhighlight it just so you can actually see it. It is made up of 24. Sorry, it's long.
6 bytes.
Represented each byte represented as a pair of hex digits. Is this going over here? Does this make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Basically, it's a number that represents your computer. Right. And so everybody's computer here is going to have a unique number. And that number is assigned by the hardware manufacturer of your computer. And so the first 6 digits here typically represent the manufacturer. Some manufacturers have lots of sets of 6 digits. And then the second set of 6 digits is usually random or sequential as generated by the manufacturer. Okay. So why is it important that they're all unique? It's because when you have a network that's local, when you have this kind of system where you have one node connected to a whole bunch of other computers directly, all those computers need to be able to talk to each other. In order to talk to each other, they need to know the addresses of their neighbors. And so at the Ethernet level, at the hardware level, every computer knows what all the neighboring computers are. They listen using a protocol called ARP, which is the address resolution protocol, to see what other people say is on the network. Yeah.
Is that your MAC address?
Yes. Yes. MAC standing for Media Access Controller. Yeah, if you ever hear MAC address, this is what it is. Okay. Any questions about?
Was that
ifconfig? Ifconfig on my Mac. It's often ipconfig on Linux.
No, it's ifconfig.
Oh, it's ifconfig?
It's ifconfig on Windows.
It's ifconfig on Windows. Thank you. Okay.
But it's HWADER on Linux. The formatting of the text is slightly different in creative ways to make it difficult.
The
shell scripts.
Yes, of course. Okay. Okay. So, every Ethernet packet, this is the little segment of data. It's usually about 1,500 bytes, so 1.5 kilobytes. And it contains a destination address, a source address, a payload, the length of the payload, and then a CRC check. This is just basically a way for computers to tell if there was some kind of like physical interruption. So like you're sitting there, you transmitted a bunch of bytes, and you know, it's not a guarantee, but if this check fails, it means that some bit maybe was switched by a cosmic ray at some point while it was traversing the physical actual link. Does that make sense? Okay. So then, we build the Ethernet up using another protocol called the Internet Protocol. And this is IP, which you've probably heard of, or at least most of you raised your hand when I asked about IP. Now there's a different set of addresses. So your computer has that MAC address, the hardware address. And also, when you connect to a physical network, you get what's called an Internet Protocol address. And this is the IP address that you've probably seen. It's four numbers separated by periods, at least in the current version of IP. It has a bunch of extra stuff, but basically a lot of the same stuff as an Ethernet packet. So this is what an IP packet looks like. This, by the way, is just pulled off of Wikipedia. There's a version number, there's a whole bunch of IP-specific stuff. There's a time to live, which will come up in just a second. A protocol, which tells you what's sitting on top of Internet Protocol. So when you've heard TCP/IP, this specifies what is actually being contained within the Internet Packet Protocol. And then there's the source IP address and the destination IP address, which you'll notice are pretty long. And then there's the actual data.
What are the X and Y dimensions?
Like what does this mean? It's just showing you 4 bytes. And then it's continuing on. So it's linear, but showing you 4 bytes at a time per call, per row.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes?
Just to clarify, you're mentioning that the packets are different under the different protocols, I guess under the Ethernet one, then you've got the destination and the source are both MAC addresses.
Right. So what happens is that there's like a whole bunch of envelopes. So the Ethernet packet contains within it an IP packet.
Thank you. That was my next.
And then the IP packet will contain within it data related to the TCP stuff. Any other questions? Okay. So, IP addresses are the ones that are globally routable, right? These are the ones that, again, are probably unique to your computer, although in most actual network deployments, they turn out not to be unique. But this is showing you what the undersea cable network looked like several years ago. But basically, I'm here, you know, Bay Area roughly, and I want to connect to the BBC. I want to see what's new in Britain. So I go to bbc.co.uk. And when I look up, you know, first thing my computer does when I type in bbc.co.uk is it turns that name into an IP address, into a number. And then it just sends packets with that number as the destination. And so what the network then does is it figures out what the next router is, so what the next computer is that knows how to get closer to BBC, that knows how to get closer to that IP address. So let's actually do this. If you have a computer and are on the internet, have a terminal window open. I'll make this bigger. But you can use a command called traceroute. And this, I think, is traceRT on Windows. And I'll say, I want to go to BBC.
Can you increase your terminal size?
Yeah. Okay. So I'll scroll up in just a second. There we go. But basically what's happening is this is showing us what routers, packets that I'm sending to the IP address associated with bbc.co.uk, where they're going. Okay, so First thing it's telling me is actually there's multiple IP addresses, so it picked one, specifically this one, 212.58, whatever, whatever. And then it's telling me that the closest, I'm actually doing this from my house, because the internet here was a little flaky earlier. So this is my IP address. This is the router for my computer at home. I have, my ISP is Sonic. So there's three, four-ish Sonic routers in the way. And a router is just a computer that is connected to a whole bunch of different computers on the internet and knows how to get data from one point to another. We'll talk about more about what that means in just a second. So, Sonic.net is my ISP, and then my ISP connects to Cogent. Anybody heard of Cogent? Yeah. It is a giant ISP that doesn't offer really residential services, but that connects other ISPs together. Cogent, not that far away. You'll notice that all of these routers also have timing information that's telling me how many milliseconds it's taking for data to get to that point. Okay. So Sonic, Cogent, not super far away. Then I get this other ISP called Telia, and Telia has in their router names a little bit of a hint as to where the router might be. So it looks like this one's in Palo Alto. This one is in San Jose. I don't know where this one is. My guess is that it's possibly possibly Ashford.
Ashford.
What's that?
I think that might be a city in England that's close to the seaside.
It could be, but it's I think the number is a little too low for that. It could be Asheville, North Carolina. That's what I was thinking.
Ashford, Ohio.
So the reason that I think it might be Asheville, North Carolina is because it's roughly 80 milliseconds away, and that's roughly the distance to the East Coast from here. And it's on the way between here and London, where presumably this router is. So as you can see, Telia has a very large network that spans from San Jose to possibly North Carolina to London. And then you'll notice that these numbers jump as I go from San Jose, which is about 10 milliseconds away, to Ashley, which is about 80 milliseconds away, to London, which is about 150 milliseconds away.
Yeah. Can you just throw in what that's based on? Like,
yeah.
At what speed according to? Okay. I mean, no, that's what I was going to ask, and that sounded like a stupid question, but
not a stupid question at all. Not at all. Yeah, these numbers are basically limited by the speed of light through glass. There's a little bit of, like, processing that happens as well that slows it down a little bit. Every router that it goes through tends to spend in milliseconds, a few milliseconds, depending on how good the router is. But yeah, generally, speed of light through glass.
Yes.
Why are there multiple entries per number?
It does three times. So, the first thing, when there's just one router, it does the, like, a number for that IP address three times. What happened here is that it sent three packets, and those packets were actually sent via different routes. So the ninth router was this IP address the first time it tried it, this IP address the second time it tried it, and this IP address the third time it tried it.
Is it sending the same packet three times?
Basically.
Okay.
So these are special packets that it sends. I mentioned very briefly that there's a field in the IP packet called time to live. And what that says is it's kind of a protection against circular loops. It says, okay, this packet can only be sent through some number of routers before you should just discard it. Okay.
Before it's stale.
Well, before it might be a circular loop is really the concern. Okay. So the way that traceroute works is it sends packets with abnormally low time to live. And so it sends a packet, to get this router, it sends a packet with a time to live of 9. And when it gets to that ninth router, that router says, oh, I can't continue forwarding this, because it gets reduced by 1 for every router that it gets sent through. And what it does is it drops it on the floor, it ignores the packet, and then sends a notice back to my computer saying, hey, I had to drop your packet. That notice is an IP packet, and that IP packet has a return address. So that's how I can figure out who that router is. Because when that router drops my abnormally low TTL packet on the floor, it sends me a notice. That make sense?
How do you go past 9?
Oh, I said the TTL 10 packet.
Oh, I have 12.
I said it's 12. The default is is usually around 64.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I have a question. I'm like way back here on the couch. But I was wondering, in general, what makes your internet connection faster or slower?
There's two different things. There's two different ways of measuring faster or slower. One of them is latency, and the other is throughput. So latency is what these numbers are that represent up here, right? So this like 10 millisecond number here, this first one up here in row one, this is the closest router to my house. I have DSL at home. That means that when I send out data, it takes about 7 to 10 milliseconds to get to that first router. So that's a limitation on my internet connection at home. Previous to DSL technologies like modems, like regular phone modems, this number was generally much higher. It was usually around 50 milliseconds. For your mobile phone, the number is going to depend very greatly on how much that particular cell tower that you're connected to is being used. It will rarely go under 30 and will usually be in the hundreds. Okay, so that's for latency. And what that means is that, you type in the name of a small web page or whatever, you're like google.com, it's just not a hugely long web page. That's going to be dominated by the latency. So if you have a high latency, it'll take a while. Also, the latency for you matters, but it also matters how far away the server is. So in this case, for the BBC, it's all the way in London, which means it's going to take 150 milliseconds to get there and back. So that's sort of a floor. But lots of large companies that have really large websites use what's called a content distribution network. So they have a whole bunch of servers all over the world, and when you type in google.com or whatever, it sends you to the closest server for you to try to reduce that latency.
Okay.
The other...
Latency numbers, are they round-trip numbers or one-way trips?
Round-trip. Yeah. The other part of your question is about throughput, and that basically depends on, when people say bandwidth, they usually mean throughput. Like, how fat is the pipe? How many bits per second can it carry? So my DSL connection at home carries, 8 megabits a second. So that's 8 million bits per second. Yeah?
So on the trace route, the latencies, is it from the last step to the next one?
Nope.
Total.
From you, total. That's right.
So lower down, there are some asterisks that
yes.
start to appear. What do those mean?
So, some routers are nice and tell you when they drop your packet on the floor, and some don't. These are the ones that don't. You'll notice I never actually got to that final IP address. That IP address doesn't. So it's just going to keep trying until I get it. I did get all the way to some router within the BBC, which was kind enough to tell me who it is and where, and that it dropped my packet on the floor, but that's it. This used to be super open, and then a whole bunch of kind of paranoid IT departments were like, oh no, we're leaking information about our internal structure of our network, and that'll make it easier for hackers. Good stuff. Sadly. Because this is kind of fun. Anyway, okay. Any other questions about, did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Any other questions about IP or traceroute?
Can you just quickly point out, you were talking about the different components of the packets?
Yes.
The destination IP, the source IP, the protocol, the payload,
yes.
Can you point those out?
I can. This?
Right.
Yeah. So here's the time to loop.
Right, in the data that we just pulled down.
Oh. Here. Right. Okay, yes. So the source address is not listed here because it's my computer's IP address. The destination address is always this for each of these lines. This is, it's going to try TTLs all the way up to 64, starting with 1. So the first packet that it sends to find the closest router, it sets the TTL to 1. What that means is that the time to live, what that means is that the first router that gets it is going to reduce it down to 0 and be like, I have to drop this on the floor. Make sense? Okay. 52 byte is going to fit into the size field, and that's pretty much all that
Thanks.
You really care about. Okay. Sorry, I'm using a lot of time here, so I'll go quicker. Okay. Any other questions about this? If you want to know just the distance, the latency between you and another node, you don't have to use traceroute. You can also just use ping. ping tends to be less supported even than traceround. A lot of servers won't give you a ping in response, but the BBC does, and this is, you know, still roughly 157. Okay. So, Internet Protocol, here's the global IP network. I send out my packet, and look, it's Asheville or whatever. That router in Asheville has this table that lists IP addresses and how to get them, how to get packets destined there closer. This is called a routing table. In this case, it's saying, yes, I have a link to router B. If you want to get closer to this IP address, go to router B. And so it sends my packet through, gets to router A from my ISP, router A then sends it to router B. Router B has its own, like, giant collection of tables, and maybe it knows about the BBC, so it just connects directly. We saw from the traceroute that there's like 15 different routers between the two, but this is just a simplified three router version. Okay. IP addresses are not allocated randomly in the same way that, or pseudo-randomly in the same way that MAC addresses are. For a long time, they were allocated in a very specific way. A quarter of them went to organizations that started the internet. A 16th of them went to this failed experiment called multicast. There's a whole bunch of unallocated, there's a bunch of never will be allocated IP addresses space, and we're actually running out of most of it. This was a map that Randall Perot made in 2006 of where internet stuff is. So, yeah.
Are you going to touch on the difference between IP6 and IP4?
I wasn't going to, but I can. Do you have a specific question or just a general question?
Well, you mentioned that we're running out of addresses, but aren't those IPv4 addresses that we're running out?
Exactly. So this is the IPv4 space, if you can read the incredibly small print up there. IPv4 has the like typical IP addresses that you may have seen, where it's like four numbers each less than 256. That yields like 32 bits worth of internet address space. When they were first building this, they were like, well, I'll never have more than 4 billion computers. Pshaw. Of course, that's like way more. We tried to fix that a little bit by not assigning every computer its own unique IP address. So, for example, if you have a router at home, it has a real IP address, and all the computers that you have in your house probably don't, unless you were very explicit. Tricks like that, lots of large companies will have like three IP addresses instead of like the thousands that they actually have computers. Okay. Anyway, that didn't 100% solve the problem because ideally you would have lots of different devices and they could all have their own like real internet addresses. You could actually communicate with them. And so I don't know what happened with IPv5. I guess they tried something and it didn't work out. But they came up with IPv6, which has addresses that are 4 times longer, and so that means that you can have, like, I don't know, more IP addresses than there are atoms in the universe, so hopefully that will, you know. they erred on the side of, it's okay. That's one major difference. There, a lot of the complexity with IPv6 is getting it to operate with IPv4. So that means a lot of IPv6 addresses kind of look like IPv4 addresses with a whole bunch of extra stuff at the beginning or end. As you can imagine, you'll notice that there's this like giant North America section and Europe and USA and Canada, and there's this like tiny Asia Pacific section in IPv4. IPv6 adoption is way higher in Asia than it is in, you know, North America, where we have more comparatively IPv4 addresses per capita than they do in Asia. Did you have a specific question about IPv6, or?
Well, I was wondering about sort of compatibility. Like, does it bring up any issues with device compatibility? Like, if I'm trying to visit a web page that's an IPv6, I guess that has an IPv6 address, do I need a browser that can? I mean, I know Chrome.
So it's not IPv6, the
but
the browser.
What is it?
It's not the browser as much as it is your ISP.
Okay.
So basically, every modern operating system has support for IPv6.
Okay.
Consequently, any software that relies on the networking connectivity of your browser that doesn't do something really archaic is gonna basically gonna support IPv6 if it's using the like operating system tools. your ISP, you can choose to route IPv6 and can provide your laptop or your computer with an IPv6 address. And if it does, and there's a route between your computer and that other server that's using IPv6, where all the routers support IPv6, then you're golden. That's all you need. If there aren't, it's not going to work. And so, we'll talk about DNS at some point. You're rarely typing in an IP address when you're going to a web page. You're typing in like a domain name, right? And domain names map to IPv4 addresses called A records, and they also can map to IPv6 addresses called AAAA records. So they're four times longer. So you can get both an IPv4 and v6 address from that lookup, and then your computer can decide to try the IPv4 or the IPv6. I haven't tried. I'd be curious to see what happens if you try to go to a website that only has an IPv6 address. I don't know if my ISP supports IPv6 or not. Maybe yours does.
Yeah. So would I have a correct understanding in saying that that IPv6 is a different internet? And so...
Pretty much.
Yeah.
There is some attempts to do backward compatibility. I think that it's like not working super well because it's not really backward compatibility. It's just less work to use. And so people who are considering using it have generally been being like, I might as well support IPv6 rather than manipulate my IPv4 implementation to support backwards compatible nature. So I think that one day it'll just be like IPv6 pretty much everywhere and like a few backwaters that are still IPv4.
Right.
Yeah.
And last question
okay. That
you could save for later. How does the Tor network relate to this?
We'll do that later. The quick answer is that it sort of sits on top of all this as its own like private network. Okay. So IP is great for you have lots of little packets and you want them to get around places. And like, you know, it's kind of like mail delivery. You have an address on the packet and the routers know how to get it there and it gets there. Okay, but generally speaking, when you're sending data over the internet, your data is probably more than 1.5 kilobytes, right? Fair to say? Yeah. Okay. So if you want to send more than 1.5 kilobytes, it doesn't fit into an IP packet, or generally doesn't fit into an IP packet. And so you need something that sits on top of IP in order to make sure that all your data gets there in the order that it's supposed to get there, et cetera, et cetera. You'll notice that when I did that trace route, you asked this great question, why were there sometimes multiple IP addresses for a given hop? Not all the packets are going to take the same route to get from me to to the destination, right? And so when they don't, they might, you know, take different routes and then arrive out of order, or one of them might be dropped, or, you know, there might be an incident and something might happen and not all my data might get there. And so you want a way, an easy way to be like, look, I don't care about this packet crap. Like, I just have this data and I want it to get there, right? That's where TCP comes in. So, TCP is our transmission control protocol, and it gives us a way to take a whole bunch of data and send it and feel pretty confident that the data is going to get there in the order that we sent it. Is going to get there in the order that we sent it. So, those are the two requirements that basically it's trying to do. Okay. So the sort of the simple problem of, oh, my packet is gone, is that TCP just gives a number to every packet. So, you know, you send 475 is the number for one packet, and the server's like, yes, I got packet 475. And then you send 476, the server's like, yes, I got that one too. And then it sends 477, et cetera. You send 478, it disappears. And you don't hear back from the server, and you're like, I'll send that one again. And you send 478 again, and the server's like, all right, I got 478. This is a simplified version of what happens, but this is basically what happens. Okay, problem number one solved. So this is how you can resend packets that disappear. And then the sequence numbers, it turns out, are also really useful for making sure all the packets arrive in order. Because it's not going to happen in this example, because I'm only sending one packet at a time and waiting to make sure it was delivered. But the transmission control aspect of TCP lets you actually send a whole bunch of packets at once. Because in this case, you would be restricted to sending one 1.5 kilobyte packet at a time, right? So So you send one 1.5 kilobyte packet, and then you wait to hear back. If I'm talking to my dude in London, that's 300 milliseconds, so I can send three 1.5 kilobyte packets. That's like 4.5 kilobytes a second. That's not okay. That's way too slow. So I send a whole bunch of packets at once, and he sends me a whole bunch of packets at once. And so these numbers are really critical for keeping track. If I send a whole bunch of packets at once, and because they go different routes, they end up getting there in a different order, the server, the person that I'm talking to, can in fact look at those numbers and be like, oh, I know what order this should go in, and reassembles the packets so that it gives the application that, like, the web server that's running on the actual server can get that data and, like, in the way that you sent it. Okay. So this slide also introduces two new terms, clients and servers. Do you guys know what clients and servers are from a technical perspective? Okay. So a server is usually sitting there somewhere, effectively sitting next to the phone. You're the client, you pick up the phone and dial. The server is the one that picks up the phone when you call it. Okay. So what that means is that there's two sides to any TCP connection. There's the server, the one that's listening, that's waiting for incoming requests. And there's the client, the one that's initiating those requests. Does that make sense? So every TCP connection goes from a client. There's a technical client and a technical server. Okay. For web stuff, it turns out that the server is usually a web server, it's aptly named, it totally makes sense. Okay. For protocols like Tor or BitTorrent or whatever, it's a little bit more confusing because they're bidirectional. Anyway, as far as this session is concerned, clients and servers. Okay. So your browser is an example of a client program, right? So you type in whatever web address in your computer. Your browser connects, so opens a connection, a TCP connection, to the web server for that domain, for that IP address. Okay? Does that make sense? And then it sends data using your operating system's TCP implementation. It says, I want to send all of this data to the server, like what page I want, etc. And then the server sends that all, you know, gets that, decodes it, it receives exactly the string that you sent. So you sent a bunch of characters, it receives those characters, it understands those characters, and then it sends you a response back. Does that make sense? Okay, let's look at this. So, there's a program on your computer called Telnet. Have you heard of Telnet?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You may have used it years and years ago if you like had a bulletin board service or like old email before things like the web. Anyway, it doesn't matter if not. The Telnet program basically allows you to open a TCP connection. Okay. I'm going to say I want a Telnet. Google, and I'm going to explain what this number is, but for now, let's just pretend it's a magic number, port 80. This really is just saying I want to talk to the web server for Google. Okay, and now I've opened my TCP connection. So your browser and I both speak HTTP, so I can tell the browser, send over this connection. I am saying that I want the page hosted at slash. You all learned about URL strings?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So like this is the home page, right, at slash. And I'm using the protocol HTTP version 1.1. And version 1.1 requires that I also tell it what host, like what server I want to be connecting to. And so I say, I want to be connecting to www.google.com. And then I send two returns. That's it. That's sort of the bare minimum HTTP request that I can send. Your browser would include a whole bunch of other information here, like what kind of browser it is, and what kind of data it knows to process. But you don't need to send any of that. It's sort of optional. Okay, so then I sent it, and the server said, okay, cool. Yep, I know how to deal with that. By the way, here's today's date. This page never expires. A whole bunch of other stuff, including, oh, this is an text/HTML document, and here's the character set. Some cookies, some other stuff, what kind of server it is, GWS is the Google web server, how it's being trained. then here's the actual data. So, here is 8,000 hex bytes of data, and here we go, the HTML. HTML, blah, 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 here's the like, et cetera, et cetera. You'll notice that Google probably uses like a minification script to make this HTML stuff all online. Here's a whole bunch of CSS that it's sending. Y'all know what CSS is. Whole bunch of CSS. A whole bunch of CSS. Ah, now some JavaScript. whole bunch of JavaScript. And that's it. And some, all there is in the header. And then there's a body. It contains a script tag where it's probably like, okay, now make the page. And then that's it. So, it sent me all the HTML for that page. Does that make sense? Okay. So I, the client, use Telnet to open a connection to the server, Google Web Server. I sent my request, which was probably less than 1.5 kilobytes, let's pretend that it was long. That was decomposed into packets. So there was a TCP header surrounding this IP, inside this IP packet, which then was sent through various Ethernet packets on the way there. It got there, the server received it, it picked up the phone, effectively saying, yes, I will accept this connection. It received the request, and then it did its little processing and said, okay, I know what to send in response to this request, an HTML page. And so it sends that HTML page back to us. And actually, in this case, it leaves the connection open, but it might have also just closed the connection. And like, this is the information you were looking for, goodbye. Does that make sense?
Okay.
So I said that I would tell you what that number means. The magic number that I included. So I said telnet www.google.com port 80, right? That number represents what's called a port. So you'll notice that we were talking about IP addresses, but an IP address refers to your whole computer, right? Your computer might have one IP address, but you probably have a whole bunch of browser tabs open on your computer. And you probably are connecting to a whole bunch of different servers, and all those servers are getting requests. All those servers probably have, well, they might or might not have multiple different programs running on them. And the operating system needs to have a way to keep track of, like, what program actually sent the request. Like, who actually wanted this data from Google.com, right? Like, you might be running Safari and Chrome, you have multiple tabs open. So your computer needs a way to keep track of, like when you open that connection, what program to send that data back to when it comes back in. And so, every TCP packet, every like piece of data that's sent using the TCP protocol, has a source port and a destination port. And remember, this sits inside the IP packet that has the source address and the destination address. And so the source port and the destination port can go up to like 65,000, and they generally uniquely describe a connection. So source address, source port, destination address, destination port, uniquely represents a connection. So when I connected via Telnet, I had my IP address and some port that the operating system gave me, and I was connecting to google.com and port 80. So why 80? It's historical. 80 was the port that was originally chosen for web servers, and so by default, any web server uses port 80, by default. You can, in your browser, specify a different port by putting colon and a number after your URL in the browser bar. But if you don't, it uses port 80, or port 443 if you're using SSL, if you're doing a secure connection. Those are the default port numbers. Okay. Any questions about ports or anything in the last 10 minutes?
So does that mean that everyone's using port 80, and so it's kind of an unused?
So all the servers are listening on port 80,
right.
But when you connect to it, you get some random high number. So you have a port on your computer so that your operating system can identify your like browser tab to send the data that comes back from Google. So if you have multiple tabs and they all go to Google, you want to make sure that they all get the specific requests that they made back, right?
But are you saying that each of my tabs gets assigned a different port?
Not strictly that structure,
okay.
But every time you make a connection, yeah, you basically get some new port.
Okay.
So in when you like load a new page, if you open like five tabs and immediately typed in like some address in all of them, then yeah, they would each have their own connections going up. They would each have their own ports going up.
But that's on my side.
On your side. They all connect to port 80. And so Google gets those connections, and the way that it knows what to send to you is that it's like where to send it, is that each connection has that like source port where it's coming from on your computer. And so when it sends it back, that's the destination port that it sends it to. It says, okay, this request came from, what's your name?
Scott.
Scott. This request came from Scott on port, you know, 25,312. He wanted to query for TCP ports. So look it up, and then I send that data back to Scott on port 25,000. Does that make sense? So if there's a second request coming in with a different query from Scott on a different port, it's going to look it up and send that query back to that port.
Right, that all makes sense. But on the other side, everyone's sending it to google.com.
Pretty much. Yeah.
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 The packet numbers?
Mm-hmm.
Sequence numbers?
Yeah.
So I send a bunch of packets out. Where's the packet number stored?
It's a sequence number in the TCP header.
And this is in the data part of the IP.
This is inside the IP packet. Yes?
Thanks, Thomas. Do
you have a question?
You don't need to just get it out of place, but I'm curious if I have my computer on the local network and I don't have a real internet IP address,
yeah.
How the packet knows to get back to me?
If you go on the local network?
If I open my laptop right now and go to google.com, how it knows to get back to my laptop.
So we talked about that earlier in the presentation.
Oh, sorry.
But there's like a routing network, and each server along the way knows the previous one. Okay. You can come up and we'll chat.
I thought it was easier to see and hear from here.
Okay. Sure.
So, can the IP packet like change its size? Like,
yeah.
If I had like nested packets and packets and packets, like.
You need a lot of headers to do that. You can't really make an IP packet larger. There's not. So you can. And what will end up happening is, let me see if I should pull it up. There's this fragment offset section. So you can send a larger IP packet, but it might be fragmented by the routers in between. Because fundamentally, under the IP is the Ethernet. And the Ethernet. Some types of Ethernet have a hard limit on how long a packet is. So an IP packet usually ends up being 1500 bytes. Even if you send a longer packet, it gets what's called fragmented. And that increases the risk that the packet's not going to be fully transmitted, because now you have like the individual TCP pieces and then the IP pieces, and if any IP piece fails, that whole packet is gone. Whereas with TCP, you can resend, but IP has no functionality for that. So it's just gone.
And in that case, the router like. It splits it and sends
individual parts, yeah.
Which splits the data part?
It splits the data part and it sends, yeah, you know, I actually don't know a huge amount of detail about that, because it comes up pretty rarely. Most people just don't send packets that are larger than that. The thing to note is, like, this TCP header here is, like, I don't know, 16 bytes out of 1500. So you need like 100 levels of protocol to like start not having room for data, and that basically never happens. Like TCP is usually the last level of protocol that has like specific headers, because anything that uses TCP is just a text stream, right? Like you saw me do my HTTP request, where it's like get slash whatever. That was another protocol, but it didn't really have like specific byte number position headers and all that stuff. It was just a bunch of text, and so like that's just what happens. People just send a bunch of text using TCP, and so there aren't like additional levels of these types of headers. Does that make sense? Yeah.
So kind of piggybacking on that a little bit, how is the payload parsed? Like, how is there what determines, is it the length or size of the packet? And how is it parsed out?
Parsed by.
Like you're talking about the data being split into.
Yeah. So your computer has a little, like a module in it, in the operating system, that's responsible for So when you run something like Telnet, right, you say, I want to open a TCP connection to this IP endpoint. And then it's the operating system that says, okay, what would you like to send? And so you type in a bunch of data, and the operating system takes that data, splits it up into 1500, you know, or actually a little bit less because of all the headers and stuff, right? Splits it up into little bits, gives it sequence numbers, and then sends it off on the network. So your operating system does that. And then it keeps track.
That sort of sounds like compiling.
Yeah, except it does this for every connection.
Okay.
So, like, every time you send data on a stream, it does this process. It splits it up in little bits and sends it as packets. It gives it sequence numbers, et cetera. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Did you have a question?
Yeah, I did. So, this might be more vocab.
That's okay.
But when you're opening up, say you're opening Telnet, you're going to google.com,
yeah.
Right? Now, is this just syntax when you're just selecting 80 as the port? Can you do colon.com?
The Telnet command just has a host and a port.
Port, okay, cool. Now, was that a HTTP method that you used to get?
Yeah, exactly.
Can you just do a quick about, I mean, how that works? Because I'm actually, when I entered that into command line, I didn't get the same response.
So here's what I did. Telnet, www.google.com,
yep.
Port 80.
Okay. Cool.
That opens the connection.
Okay.
So by the time you see connected to www.google.com, all a bunch of packets have already been exchanged.
Okay.
So I've told google.com, hey, I want to send you some data. Google.com has said, okay, already. I'm ready to listen to your data.
Okay.
So that's what this I'm connected means. Okay. Then I send the HTTP spec, which you can look up on Wikipedia, is method, so get, post, you know, put, delete, update, head, whatever they are, options. We'll come to that in a bit. Okay. Then the URL. And in this case, the URL is just a slash. So you're not including the host information anymore in the URL. It's just the stuff after the host. Okay. So like slash or slash query if you were like doing a search on Google or something like that. Right? And if you're doing an actual search, it would be like slash search question mark Q equals whatever, whatever.
Gotcha.
Okay. And then this says what version of HTTP it is. Any other questions? Yeah.
Where does checksum come in on this?
So there's like multiple levels of checksum here.
Okay.
There's every TCP packet. Every TCP packet has a checksum. That's 16 bits. TCP packets are inside IP packets, which also have a checksum, although only for the header, but it doesn't matter. And then Ethernet packets also have a checksum. So there's like four levels of checksum, basically. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
What is checksum?
Checksum is basically you have a whole bunch of bits you want to send.
Right.
And you want to kind of make sure that those bits got there correctly. So you do essentially a mathematical function over all the bits. So you could imagine, for example, adding all the one bits together, right? So it's like, how many one bits are there in this string that I want to send? And then adding that to the end of your message. And then the receiver, right, the server, gets that data, and it says, okay, there were supposed to be this number of ones in the message, and there are, so that's probably correct. Or there aren't, so it must be, you know, broken somehow. But of course, it's more complicated than that. It's not just counting the number of ones. There's like CRC. I don't know how many of these use CRC. Ethernet at least does. It's called a cyclic redundancy check. So it, like, every time there's a one or a zero or a full byte or whatever, it does this like convoluted math. And so the idea is to make it so that if just one bit switched, it triggers. But if like several bits switched, it also triggers. Summing all the ones is sort of broken because if like two bits just swapped, that wouldn't break anything. But like in this, there would still be the same number of ones. But CRC fixes that by like not just counting the number of ones, but like taking into account where their position is, and like all that kind of stuff.
So it's a cheap way of finding out if the package is kosher without
exactly.
Looking at it.
Without seeing if any of the bits have changed, without understanding what those bits mean. Any other questions?
connections can a server generally handle? We all know, you know.
A lot.
Let's leave it at a lot.
It depends on the operating system. Mm-hmm. You could have, like, hundreds of thousands or millions if you wanted to. Mm-hmm. You're not restricted, like, they're all connected to the same port on your server. And so what actually makes them unique is where they're coming from. And so, like, you could theoretically, with these protocols, have, like, 65,000 connections from every possible IP address, and you would still be okay. But your server may not be able to handle all those requests.
Yeah. There's, like, a file descriptor limit.
Yeah.
Which you would hit. But
I didn't hear that.
You would hit, like, a file descriptor limit. So, like, there's, like, this particular resource that the kernel provides for every connection, and those are limited. There's only a certain number you can have. And so you probably hit that limit long before you had 65,000 connections.
Can we talk? Can you explain that better later?
Yes, sure.
Pretty cool.
Okay. You want to talk about DNS then? Sure.
No, it's fine.
Oh, okay.
It doesn't matter. I just have some guns on demos.
Awesome.
Demystify a little.